Exploring Isaac Asimov's Non-Fiction.
Welcome, one and all, to the most remarkable adventure to come out of the halls of science since the invention of science fiction. In this series, we'll be taking a look at the various non-fictional works of Isaac Asimov, from dinosaurs to archaeologists. If you're wondering, one doesn't study the other. From history to the stars. If there was a branch of science attached to it, Dr. Asimov probably wrote about it in his non-fiction books, or at least one of his essays. Come with me as we explore Asimov's non-fiction. Episode 001, Biochemistry and Human Metabolism. How do I describe him? Isaac Asimov, the man, the mystery, the stories, the essays, the books, and the scientist. The first book I read by Isaac Asimov, Norby the Mixed Up Robot, was mostly co-written by his second wife, Janet Opal Jepson Asimov. It was the first in a series of 11 novels about this robot and his owner, Jeff. I later went on to read his other science fiction stories, which were pretty good. But I really got interested in Isaac Asimov's work when I read his essays for the magazine of fantasy and science fiction. I then delved into his nonfiction books and enjoyed learning about all the various topics he wished to discuss. Basically, every branch of science and discovery that he could find, he liked to learn about, and then he'd write an article about it. Sometimes just one topic would grow into an entire book. With all his hundreds of books, I could not hope to get them all, or read all his essays, many of which still haven't made it out of their original magazine homes and into published book form. I collected as many of his books as I could, but I didn't really know much about the man himself until after he died. Sadly, after he died, his nonfiction books began to get outdated, and libraries started to get rid of them. The books I wanted to read were now starting to disappear from the libraries. Even interlibrary loaning the books got difficult. That is when sites like eBay helped me to get some of the more interesting and less popular books. Imagine my joy in being able to buy this first book of his nonfiction works. Biochemistry and Human Metabolism is Isaac Asimov's eighth published book. It is a textbook for medical students that was first published in 1952 and originally cost $9. He wrote it with two co-authors, both of which were also professors at the Boston University School of Medicine. They were Barnham Sorrell Walker, MD and PhD, and William Clauser Boyd, PhD. And just in case you were wondering, Barnham is not the circus guy. That name is spelled differently. Isaac Asimov is famous for his simple style and the way he tries to insert random facts connected with the subject he is discussing to arouse interest in the reader about other subjects. Sadly, most people only know about his fictional creations. This book began as an idea in 1950 by William Bill Boyd. Bill suggested that he and Isaac could collaborate on a school textbook. This was while Isaac was still an instructor at the school and not yet a professor. However, because Asimov was an employee of the school, he decided to ask his academic employer, Barnham Walker, for permission to work on the project while at school. Walker then joined them in the creation of the book. During their work on the project, Isaac became associate professor of biochemistry. They'd work on this book off and on again for the next 7 years, creating three editions of the book. Walker suggested that they use the textbook publisher, the William & Wilkins Company, to produce their book. Isaac wrote about this book in his first volume of his autobiography, explaining that he tried to make his part of the book chatty, colloquial, and dramatic, but each word of the book was discussed as a committee by all three writers. He felt that Boyd was siding with Walker most of the time when decisions of style were made. Isaac mentions in his autobiography that he was responsible for writing chapter 2, titled Protein Structure. He also mentions that he tried to work on the book only while he was working at the school. Sadly, he does not list any of the other chapters he worked on. He also mentions that it took a little over a year to write the book, and he was responsible for about a third of its content, and the first edition was about 300,000 words in length. He and the two co-authors proofread the book, as well as the book publishers doing it themselves, but it turned out there were still errors in the final book, which none of them had managed to catch. They eventually came to the humorous conclusion that when finding inconsistencies in the book, which seemed small enough to ignore, they would quote Ralph Waldo Emerson, leave the phrase as it was, and move on. The quote was, "A foolish consistency is the hobgoblin of little minds," from Emerson's essay titled Self-Reliance. A different quote from Emerson also inspired Asimov to write the story Nightfall. The final part was indexing the book. This was Isaac's first attempt at indexing a book, and he found that he enjoyed it. According to the first volume of his autobiography, he had previously been indexing the authors and stories of the science fiction magazines he owned. This inspired him to try and write a story himself. At first, Isaac and his co-authors indexed their own sections of the book, but Asimov was unsatisfied with how the others did it, so he did the compilation of all the indexes himself. For his book A Short History of Biology, someone else had done the index for one of his books. In the second volume of his autobiography, he mentions how much he disliked it, and found that it was not useful for his type of working. He would usually go back to his other books, search their index, and look up a subject he had already written about. in another instance which he wanted to make an index for his book, The Intelligent Man's Guide to Science. He was even charged $500 from his royalties for someone else to do the index. He thought that the person had done a dreadful and rotten job of it. After the book was printed, a friend of his famously opened it to a random page and found an error in one of the book's formulas. They used the book in their classes, but the students were encouraged to find more of the errors in the book. Although this could be thought of as free proofreaders, they were given trivial bonuses, such as money for finding errors, which he mentions became a serious financial drain. Isaac described his process of making corrections and additions to his books in the second volume of his autobiography. He would take two copies of the book apart, paste each page on typing paper, that's why he needed two copies, so he could have the front and the back of each page, and then write corrections in the margins on the typing paper. Isaac said of the sales of the book that it was a distressing failure, compounded by the fact that two new books on the same subject had also been released around that time, and he thought those were better. Although they worked on later editions of the book, making corrections and updating the book until 1957 for its third edition, he felt that they could not make its weakness into a success. There is a review of this book in the Science magazine for the November 28, 1952 issue on pages 604 and 605 by the AAAS, American Association for the Advancement of Science. Although Isaac was disappointed in the work and having to co-author the book, Walker, however, did enjoy the project. He even offered to co-write a second book with Isaac, this time a textbook for student nurses. They teamed up with a woman named M. Collet Nicholas, whom was also working on a similar book at the time. Together, they wrote Chemistry and Human Health, and it was published in 1956 by McGraw-Hill Company, Incorporated, under their Blakeston division. Isaac also wrote another book with William Clauser Boyd called Races and People, published in 1956 by Abelard and Schumann. The first edition of the book was published in 1952 with a bluish-green cover and a black spine panel. The second edition, printed in 1954, featured a red cover with the black panel. Asimov likened the preparation of the second edition as to writing an entirely new book, but he was not quite willing to include it again on the list of his published books. The third edition from 1957 featured a black cover with a red panel on the spine. The publisher's crest can be found on the book's title page and spine. It is an illustration of a wreath surrounding a bent fish, and at the center it has the words Santosh, without stain. Other than this, there are hardly any illustrations in this book. Instead, there are diagrams, charts, tables, and a few photographs. There are, however, lots of formula equations. After the first edition of the book, the second and third editions on the spine list what number of edition they are, next to the title and author's names. The first and second editions of the book had a foreword by John T. Edsel, M.D., a professor of biological chemistry at Harvard University. This was later removed for the third edition. The book was printed by Waverly Press, Incorporated. There was no dust jacket for this book, as it was a textbook. Many students seem to have inscribed their names on their books. They also presumably took it to classes, possibly underlining phrases, and used it to study. Surprisingly, most copies of the book are still in good shape, while other copies were probably bought by school libraries and had the usual library markings attached to them. The contents and arrangement of the chapters and their titles changed from one edition to the next. The book was divided into several sections, with each section consisting of various chapters. The book sections were structure, control, growth, metabolism, and pathology, with various topics covered in each chapter. Things like thermodynamics, photosynthesis, and other processes leading up to human metabolism are also discussed. However, in the first and second editions of this book, most of this information was placed in a sixth section of the book, the appendices. For the third edition, much of this section was moved to the earlier chapters, with the only remaining appendix topic being an explanation of the isotopes of an atom. After each chapter and the appendix, there is a list of references used for that section. I like to think of this book as a parallel to H.G. Herbert George Wells's textbook in biology / textbook in zoology. Yes, the same guy that wrote The Time Machine and The War of the Worlds. Wells also wrote similar nonfiction, like The Outline of History and The Science of Life books, all of which helped to educate the reader on scientific topics. They both loved science, and Asimov even wrote an autobiography of his own life, which was similar to Wells's experiment in autobiography. They both wrote on various scientific topics, while Wells seemed to be more interested in sociology and politics, while Asimov tried to cover every branch of science in a lighthearted way, including such topics as limericks, poems, and jokes. Asimov wrote about each of these subjects, but his histories and his essays are my first thoughts when I think of Asimov's nonfiction. Although some people may look at this book and find it a bit dull, stilted, and uninteresting, I like to think of it as being able to go back in time, sitting down in a school lecture hall, and getting a glimpse of the classes that Isaac Asimov was required to teach at the time. If you like science lectures, or you want to learn outdated theories in biology, this is an interesting book to see what was known about the subject when it was written. Although it may not have been one of Isaac's favorite books, it was the starting point in his nonfiction writing career, which lasted up until the time of his death. If it were only for that reason alone, it would still be one of my most treasured possessions. Although to get a complete view of the entirety of the book, you'd have to own all three editions. And then you can enjoy trying finding the changes and errors that they fixed. If you're the kind of person who would buy a rock because it had a fossil on it, I think you would be fascinated by this book. But if you only want to sit back and listen to a story and not learn about the process behind the discoveries, then you might want to pass on this book. But either way, it's a smaller piece of the larger Asimov collection that I think is largely overlooked. Asimov himself summed up his 7 years' work on this book as, "It was a failure from beginning to end."